but might as well start. My name is Alex Storr, and I'm graduating tomorrow, which is really exciting. And my field of study is microremediation, so it's using fungi to degrade toxic waste, or fungal bioremediation. So here we are on planet Earth, a familiar blue ball floating in the sky, and this is what we're doing to it. Or at least some humans are, not all of us, hopefully. If the Earth formed at midnight and the present moment is the next midnight, 24 hours later, modern humans have been around since 11:59:59 p.m., 1 second. And in that 1 second, if we span that out another 24 hours, the time since Christ has been 14 minutes. And then we talk about the Industrial Age, and that was not too far ago. And in that time, our population has increased dramatically. And along with the population increase, we have increase of pollution. So there's an estimated 80 billion pounds of hazardous organic pollutants that are produced annually by the chemical, agricultural, oil, paper, textile, aerospace, and other industries in the USA alone. Only about 10% of those are believed to be disposed in a proper means. And along that, we are clear-cutting forests, we are mining, and we are destroying ourselves with bombs and chemical warfare, and creating mass genocide and slavery, and spraying the food that we use to nourish ourselves with chemicals. And beyond that, we're even making food out of chemicals to feed ourselves. So this is kind of a layout of our evolution. We evolved from the ocean, and then we're turning around to pour toxic waste into our oceans. And then we have a system where we have these big companies advertising to our people and saying, you do not have enough, and you need this product to fill that gap. So we work jobs to get this money, to buy the things that we see on advertisements. And we go out and we buy them, and in 6 months, 90% of what we buy is disposed. And to make these products, we use a process of extractivism, which is mining. We're extracting natural resources from our earth at an exponential rate, and producing products in factories. And most of the time, these sites of extractivism are on land that are of indigenous people's land, or people of color, or any marginalized groups, and it's affecting their land and their people, and the people that are working in these factories are other marginalized people, either in another country or in our country. And then we distribute the products, and the cycle continues of consumerism, and again, we dispose 90% of the stuff we buy in 6 months. So what's the solution? Fungi. It's one solution, but it's a great one. And it all revolves around healing. So the first we can see is medicinal mushrooms. We've been using medicinal mushrooms for thousands of years. Reishi, chaga, you can find these all in the woods. There's great research coming out with psychedelic mushrooms and curing depression, PTSD, culinary mushrooms, and we can transform agricultural waste into nutritive food. That we can use to nourish our bodies. Micro-restoration, so in areas where we have logged or mined, we can use fungi to protect plants against different viruses and make them stronger and drought-resistant. And then the final topic is micro-remediation. So when we use these processes of extractivism and we dispose of toxic waste, whether it be an oil spill or pesticide use, we can use fungi to break down these chemicals. Three pollutants that fungi can focus on are, the first is bacterium. So an example would be E. coli. Another mode that they work on is metals. So an example would be arsenic. And then chemicals, so an example would be atrazine. And they do this through, how they degrade chemicals is through their mycelium, which is kind of the root structure of the fungi. You can think of it like an apple tree and the mushrooms are the apples, except the apple tree is underground. This is the main rooting structure of the fungi. And they're like us, they degrade, they eat their own food, and they take in oxygen and let out CO2. Except when we eat our food or I drink this lemonade, I have enzymes and acids in my stomach to break it down. With fungi, they excrete those acids externally and break down their food outside of their body. So there's white rot and brown rot fungi. White rot break down the lignin. It's kind of the hardier structure of plants. And brown rot breaks down the cellulose, which is a lot softer. So you can see in this bottom picture, these are the exudates, or the secondary metabolites that are excreted from the fungi. And some of those enzymes that they excrete are lignin peroxidase, manganese peroxidase, and lactases. So this is the structure of lignin. It's one of the most complex molecules on planet Earth, and only fungi have the capabilities of breaking it down. And it's a three-dimensional compound that's always different. And how fungi break it down and other chemicals is the use of free radical oxidization. So they excrete H2O2, which you can see here, and they break it apart into H2O and a free radical oxygen. The free radical oxygen bounces around in this molecule and binds to reactor sites, stealing electrons and breaking the molecule apart. And so they don't really care what the molecule is. They're non-specific, so they can break down any molecule if it's close to lignin, which a lot of our anthropogenic xenotoxins are close to lignin, so they have ability to break down oil, as you can see, and other chemicals. How they work to filter bacteria is through, they make a mycelial filter, as you can see below. This is an electron microscopic image of mycelium. And they can filter, these are some common bacteria and viruses that they can filter out of our water. And so as they pass through this mycelium, they can trap these different bacteria and viruses in cleaner water. Another thing they can work on is heavy metals. So this is a real problem, as you can see, like in Flint, Michigan, where the lead levels were crazy high and causing a lot of damage to a lot of people. So they work. There's one method, microsorption. Basically, the metals bind to the mycelium. And so there's this group, VTT Technical from Finland, and they basically use electronic waste, and so $21 billion per year is thrown out into our landfills of electronic waste, where gold and silver nanoparticles are trapped into the electronic waste. Recently, we've been doing like a chemical process which extracts 10 to 20% of this, but using mycelium, we're able to extract 80% of this $21 billion. Out of our landfills of gold and silver. Another method is solubilization, so basically making the metals immobile so they don't go anywhere. And that's kind of like our key. What we're trying to do is make them not go into our waterways and into our drinking cup, and just make them stop where they are. Another method, which is pretty cool, is it sucks up metals into its organelle system. And basically, if you think of it, if there's metals in the soil, a mushroom is picking it up and purging it out of the soil for us to pick up the mushrooms and dispose of them. And we can actually burn these mushrooms and extract the metals off of them and do similar to what the mining company is doing. So a lot of gold miners are doing this with plants, and so they're taking nanoparticles of gold and burning the plants, and then basically mining the gold off of it, and it's a $1 billion industry It's really profitable. And there's huge potential in microremediation. So we can see these are some common industrial techniques for soil remediation. And you can see microremediation is the cheapest method. A lot of these methods that cost more definitely clean up the pollution a lot faster, but sometimes they cause more harm to the land because we're using incineration that's using fire to burn, and some of these chemicals are volatile or heavy metals, and so they go into the air, or using chemicals to clean up a chemical spill, which is kind of illogical. We should use organisms that are from a healthy environment to bring back a toxic environment to a healthy environment. And there's different ways to go about microremediation, from research, industrial scale, commercial, to citizen science, kind of grassroots DIY. And to really push forward with this industry, we need a combination of all four. So whether it's research in the lab, on petri dishes, or different prototypes like bench scale, industrial, so we're cleaning up an industrial brownfield site or Superfund site. Commercial, so this is GrowCycle, they're in Canada, and they're basically recycling agricultural waste and turning it into food. And citizen science, this is Amazon Micro Renewal Project, which I'm working with. They're in this Cumbios region in Ecuador, and they basically super grassroots, super DIY, low-tech methods, and they have a lot of education. And the history of microremediation is very brief. So we've been using bioremediation, bacteria, since 600 BC. The Romans were using it to clean their water, but you know, microremediation hasn't been around for that long. It's only the earliest 20th century, the last 30, 40 years. So there's a lot of different improvements we can do. This is one of the most famous kind of examples of microremediation. It was in Paul Stamets' book where he detoxified an oil pit that was the same concentration level of the Gulf oil spill, and he kind of brought it down 40,000 times. But in his write-up, which he doesn't talk about in his book, these did not pass the prescribed criteria for success for the method A cleanup level. So it's great, and it brought it down a lot. And it was great that he used natural organisms, and plants started growing on the pit, and birds started coming, and I'm sure if he did the study for longer, we would see better results. In 1970, we figured out that mushrooms grow in the presence of bacteria, so they like to be in the presence of bacteria, and they can actually eat bacteria. So this was really useful for E. coli and cleaning up waterways. In 1980, we found a really great potential fungi, P. chirosporium, which can break down a lot of industrial waste. In 1990s, we're doing a lot of research with industrial waste, like oil and different chemicals. In the 2000s, we were doing a lot of research with pesticides and a lot of fertilizers. And then early 2000s, a lot of books started coming out about this, Mycelium Running, Microremediation, and then once those books were out, a lot of people took these skills and started using them grassroots, and so that was the kind of age of application. And then these two books just came out, and they're really awesome, a lot of low-tech methods, so it's kind of giving these skills to people who don't know anything about fungi, and kind of giving them tools to and the power to be able to clean up an oil spill with industrial waste and or agricultural waste. And so 2017, I've been writing this book, so hopefully it will come out by August, and so that'll be another addition to the book list. So let's talk about what I've been doing for my Div 3. That was kind of a brief intro. I wish I had more time to go in depth about those things, but I've been really fascinated with the biodegradation of cigarette butts and the chemicals within them. I used to be a smoker, and I quit, and I got really into mushrooms, and I figured out that they can degrade a lot of toxins in them. So it was kind of like my contribution to what I was doing, and I I have to admit, like, during times I have flicked a cigarette butt on the ground, and, you know, I feel like everyone in this room has seen them everywhere, or known someone, a family member who has been smoking, or gotten lung cancer or something along those lines. So I feel like it's a personal topic for everyone. Either they've seen it or they've experienced it within their own family or friends. So I did experiments like for the last 2 years, trying to get fungi to grow on them. And once I figured that out, then it was kind of blasting forward. So in the fall, I got mushrooms to fruit off of them. And so I took these mushrooms and I sent them to the lab to figure out if they were extracting the heavy metals from the cigarette butts. And yeah, cigarette butts have heavy metals in them. It's pretty gross. So the results came back and they were way too toxic for humans to eat them. So basically, there was one research paper out in the early 90s about using fungi to degrade or grow on cigarette butts. And they basically laid out in the last 5 pages kind of a budget for third world countries to make a business out of growing mushrooms off this waste, and how profitable this business was. So this research was really impactful to kind of debunk that research paper and say don't grow mushrooms off of it. And then this semester I did more research on how to degrade the actual toxins that are leachating off the cigarette butts. So a lot of times it's not really the problem of the actual cigarette butt degrading. Cigarette butts are made of cellulose acetate, which is a plasticized form of cellulose. And you know, birds will eat it and choke on it and it'll be really toxic, but the most toxic part is the leachates from them. So whether they're polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons or the heavy metals. So I wanted to figure out if they can degrade those leachates, specifically polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, which are really carcinogenic and really toxic. So I set up some jars. 3 had fungal mycelium in them, 3 had mycelium and compost tea, 3 had just compost tea, 3 had enzymes or secondary metabolites from the mycelium, and then I had 2 controls. So I got my materials. I did these experiments in mason jars with a polyfilter top so they can breathe and exchange CO2 and oxygen without letting bacteria to enter the lid. This is mycelium from a local mushroom farm, Fungi Ally. And then I just bought these cigarettes from the store. This is compost tea that I got, and I basically brewed it in this bucket and extracted enzymes. You can see in the corner of that bag. As we were talking about before, these enzymes or secondary metabolites break down. This is growing on sawdust, so it's breaking down the material and becoming food available for the mushroom to grow. So you can extract them, and basically a lot of research is coming out that we can get new antibiotics from these secondary metabolites, since they digest their food externally, so they have to secrete also antimicrobials, antibiotics, antibacterial, antifungal properties, as well as properties to degrade toxic waste. So in this jar is probably new antibiotics and also means to degrade oil spills and other crazy stuff. And this is just from a mushroom farm right down the road. And you can get this magic jar for free. And so I learned from previous studies, you have to train the fungi on unsmoked cigarette butts first. So if you give them smoked cigarette butts, it's too toxic for them and they won't grow as fast on it. But if you give them unsmoked cigarette butts first, then they'll like, okay, I can grow on this and this is fine. And then once you give them the smoked ones, then they're used to the substrate and they can grow more easily. So these are the jars all set up with the different substrates and the cigarette butts in them. And I went around Hampshire campus and I made these jars to collect cigarette butts from different people. I made this print of this guy smoking a cigarette butt, and he was like in high school, and I thought it was really cool, and like, and I saw it on my fridge, and I thought it would be perfect for this experiment, and it was kind of perfect that, you know, I made it, and it was kind of sitting on my fridge right when I was collecting it. And I thought it'd be cool, once this filled up with cigarette butts, to have a picture of a mushroom fruiting off of it. So I collected them and kind of separated them from their categories. And I made sure like each smoker smoked a different kind so they wouldn't get all mixed up. And so I put the same amount of each in each jar. And I waited a week once I added the unsmoked ones, so the bacteria and the fungi got used to the non-toxic form of the cellulose acetate, and then I added the toxic ones, so they got on munching with those. And I sent samples in of all the different substrates, and the results came back from the dirty cigarette butts of how many polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons they have. So the results in bold are the ones that are coming up and are above the threshold of detectable limits. So those in bold are the ones that are toxic and are coming through. So after I made graphs of all the data, I sent it in for testing every 2 weeks. And I didn't really need to do that because I learned that after 2 weeks, they're able to degrade all the pHs under detectable limits or completely. This is from just the mycelium. This is oyster mushrooms. This is from oyster mushrooms and compost tea. After 28 days, they're still a little above detectable limits, but then after 42 days, they're under detectable limits again. This is from the enzymes, and completely after 2 weeks, they were able to degrade all the pHs in the cigarette butts, and same with compost tea. The controls, I didn't test them every 2 weeks, I tested them after 42 days, and so that kind of complicated the data a little bit, but after 42 days they were below detectable limits, and same with the control liquid, which was just water. And this was after a while. This is a big cake of cigarette butts and sawdust, and I have mushrooms fruiting off of it. So I took a spore print of this mushroom. So that basically, it's creating new DNA in under the gills, and it's creating spores. So with the spore print, I have spores or seeds, and it's basically creating a new strain that's more adaptable to these toxins and more adaptable to cigarette butts. So now I have new strains that are more adaptable to these toxins available. So conclusions from this research, fungal enzymes in combination with compost tea is awesome for degrading toxic waste. And I feel like it would be great as a spray, an industrial spray, to spray on an oil spill, either in the ocean or on land. And I didn't even have to train the mycelium that much. And I basically took enzymes from a commercial mushroom farm, which is just eating sawdust. A lot of people think that you need to slowly adapt the mushroom or the mycelium to different toxins, and I didn't really do that much. So that kind of opens up the potential of just using straight enzymes from a commercial mushroom farm and using it for an oil spill, etc. Definitely more research on all of this needs to be done. And I think, you know, after this research, I had an epiphany that we need to extract these enzymes on an industrial scale and, you know, take a fire truck and just like go on a Superfund site or a brownfield site or an oil spill and just spray compost tea with these enzymes on it, and it will break it down. And even in this industrial scale, we can slowly feed it these toxins so they adapt and evolve to these toxins. And even an airplane. So this is like huge scale, so if we have another Gulf oil spill, then we just take airplanes. They already do this with dispersants for industrial oil cleanup. and they drop dispersants, which is like, you know, when you're washing an oily pan and you see they bead up into small beads. It's basically what they do for oil, and then they go under the ocean and they're like, we solved it, which isn't really doing anything. But instead, we can use bacterial tea and enzymes which are adapted to the oil and spray it on, you know, hundreds of acres to solve this problem. And this is something that I'm working with the project, Amazon Micro Renewal Project. They changed their name to Co-Renewal, but they haven't made a new logo yet. This is really beautiful. So they're working with a microbiologist, Robert Rawson, and this is in the Sucumbíos region of Ecuador. And he invented this. This is kind of like a huge compost tea kind of brewer. And they're working on a site in Cascales, Ecuador, and I'm working with a local water system. And so they have municipality waste going into the river, in addition to like tannery waste and you know, butchery waste. And they're filtering it through these barrels with compost tea and biochar and all these things and cleaning the water. And so we're thinking about using enzymes and fungi to help clean it more. This is a picture with the mayor from Cascales. So that's Robert Rawson in the blue shirt over there. And he has this this bacterial blend called iOS 500 that he basically sprays on huge oil spills and landfills, and basically uses windrow composting to hot compost it and have the bacteria remediate the toxins. So I'm working with this group to isolate soil from oil pits that are like 40 years old, and obviously microbial life has adapted to those toxins for the last 40 years, and they've evolved and they've unlocked pathways to excrete enzymes to better break down this oil. So we're gonna take the soil and use enzyme assays with DNA testing to basically get the fungal biodiversity and the bacterial biodiversity and basically amp it up and grow them on a large scale and use them with low-tech methods to try to remediate this oil and also oil spills all over. So isolating local adapted microbial biodiversity to address anthropogenic xenotoxins. Anthropogenic just means human-made. Xenotoxins is a toxin that's not, it's foreign from the environment. These are pictures from the oil spill in Sucumbíos region. It's really thick, and there's thousands of oil pits all in the Amazon rainforest, and it's caused thousands of cases of cancer in indigenous people, and it's really wreaking havoc to the people and the environment. This picture is really blurry, but you can do the same thing with floating gyres of plastic in the ocean. So we have huge islands of plastic in the ocean the size of Texas, just floating plastic bottles and plastic bags and stuff. And obviously they've been floating there for a while, so we can isolate different bacterial life, fungal life, and basically ramp them up to spray with an airplane on these floating islands of trash. So I think the key is using the bacteria and the fungi that are already present to address these huge toxic wastes. So a lot of times with our plastic, we've basically made them bacterial and fungal resistant. So early forms of plastic were being degraded by fungi and bacteria really fast, and so we use that knowledge to make bacteria and fungal resistant plastics, but you know, we can't fight them for long. They evolve super, super quick, and so we can use them to our advantage. This is a company, Filterra, which we just reached out to. They make these little boxes that go in sewer systems, and basically they plant a tree and the water runs off either a parking lot into these little boxes, and hopefully filters the water and then it goes into existing sewer systems. So I was just in Austin, Texas, and we decided to make like a study out of it and use the existing system that Filterra has, but add fungi to it. So we made these test buckets with the plants in them, and we're gonna add mycorrhizal fungi, which attaches to the roots of plants and helps break down toxins and helps filter bacteria and etc. And also mycelium on the top to help filter toxins. Coming up June 1st through 4th, I'm teaching or co-teaching a workshop in Vermont with Tri Cotter. He was one of the authors of the books that I showed. Really awesome. If you're around and free, definitely recommend coming out. And moving forward, we need to connect with everyone from different skills, whoever you are, because we can't tackle any problem without coming together with our different skills. We need to learn as much as we can. We need to teach what we have learned, and we need to make everything open source and basically not lock anything up in any system, because we're all in this together, we're all on the same planet. And you know, that's a tricky topic, open source, but we're learning how to do it very well. We need to prepare for, you know, events that are gonna happen, hurricanes, food shortages, viruses, you know, wiping out humans, and we need to take a look in the mirror and be like, this is gonna happen, and so we need to prepare. And then take action. So take a lesson plan, kind of a guideline to, if this is gonna happen, what are we gonna do? And then take action of what has already happened and then what is going to happen. I just found this sticky note and I thought it was really great. So yeah, that's me. Thank you. Thanks. Anyone have any questions? I know I went over the time, so you're free to leave if you want, if you have any questions.
What do you mean by composting?
Composting is using compost, so it's like degraded organic material, and then using bacteria that feed off the organic material and basically breeding it in a liquid. So it's like a spray of bacteria.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of funny in a way, because it's like a lot of, you know, industrialized society has this notion that we're so developed and we're so intelligent and we're outsmarting nature, and it's really this process of kind of taking the path of least resistance, mm-hmm. because ultimately, yeah, we are just going to become swallowed up, and that is our fate, you know, and it's really cool to think about how these huge advancements that we've had in technology are really quite minute, really, when they can just, I mean, however, you know, drastic they've been and they've furthered us, they've been so toxic to us.
Right.
And we can't measure the toxicity, and we don't want to acknowledge that. And that's our biggest problem. And this is just showing that, like, within a very tiny amount of time, fungi, bacteria, you know, and the enzymes that connect them will quickly, like, it almost makes it as if it just didn't even exist. You know, this catastrophic mistake. You know, and maybe it wasn't a mistake, it was probably just a process, but it's really cool seeing this because it's so applicable and it's like exactly what we need. Mm-hmm. So.
And the only way we can move forward is if we clean up our mess along the way.
Exactly.
You know, if we're cooking and we just like don't clean up our mess, we can't keep on cooking.
Right.
You know, it's as simple as that.
Right.
And we don't have the resources, so we need to learn recycling. We need to learn the cycles of nature. Prime example is the Amazon rainforest. They don't have a lot of soil because it's always being recycled. And we need death and decay in order for life to flourish.
For sure.
So we need to learn from organisms that have been here way before us, since, you know, the start of life, and learn how they have adapted. Because it seems like our time here is running a little short, and you know, there's news flashes of that, you see it every day,
right.
And you know, wild theories of it, and you know, it's becoming more realer every day. So we need to learn from organisms that have lived and adapted throughout all of time for billions of years.
Sure.
And be like, all right, I see how you're doing it, and you're doing it sustainably.
Right.
So yeah, we can go to Mars. We can do all these things. But if we can't, you know, if we can't do that forever, then what's the point? If we're just gonna burn out.
Totally.
So you were saying that the mushrooms became toxic and were not edible. So what happens then? So what happens with those mushrooms now that you've got the toxins sequestered in the mushroom? Then what's next?
Yeah. So I don't really see a industrial application for cigarette butts. So like one of the methods would be the sewer drains that I was talking about at the end. So it's not really addressing the cigarette butts, but all the leachates in combination. So the pesticides on lawns and runoff from the cars and everything. And you can see in the picture there's a tree growing. So plants are really great at hyperaccumulating heavy metals and just kind of keeping it in this big structure that won't degrade really fast. Mushrooms grow and then they melt away. It's a little tricky with mycelium and mushrooms with heavy metals. There's this great group TerraCycle, so you can send cigarette butts to them. They'll melt it down and make like ashtrays and tables out of it. And I think it's way cooler than what I'm doing. But it's like, I picked cigarette butts because it's a toxin that everyone can identify with, and it's something that I can go right out my door and just pick up. You know, so it's something that's really accessible to people. It was accessible to me. So yeah, I don't know if that answered your question. Yeah, you can send the mushrooms to an incinerator to burn away the mushroom material and extract the heavy metals. You can throw them in a bog and they'll just sit there for like 100 years and not move. You can throw them in a concrete box and plant a big tree over it that's not fruit or nut producing, so no humans or animals are going to eat it. You basically just want the metals trapped. All in one place and trapped, not going anywhere. Yeah.
So to follow up on that question, would you say that's the biggest barrier to making it more of an industrial scale, is that there just isn't that next step? Like if you were to make a plain size version of like a spray, like then what? Is that kind of the issue, or is there a different barrier, do you think?
Yeah, I think heavy metals are the biggest barrier with bioremediation. A lot of people use phytoremediation using plants, and I think plants are like the key answer to using heavy metals, to absorbing it into their systems, because plants, you know, a tree will last, it can last hundreds of years and just be this big tree, and it has huge roots to suck up a lot of water. In the ocean it's a little more difficult with heavy metals. I don't know how to address that.
Okay.
But yeah, chemicals are really easy to degrade. If they don't have heavy metals, then they're pretty easy. Bacteria also is pretty easy to filter, and we're figuring out better methods for that. Anybody else?
So can you give like an example of like the time scale that you would see mushrooms that clean up a mess of, you know, whatever size?
Yeah, so it's not only fungi or mushrooms. So it's like a multi-stage process. First I would use fungi, and they're really great at degrading kind of bigger molecules. And then once those are degraded further to smaller molecules, then adding bacteria to the mix, and those are really good at breaking down smaller molecules. And then adding plants, so if there's heavy metals, to suck up the heavy metals. And it all depends on the site. You know, if it's in the ocean, it's a totally different protocol. Is it in a river, a stream, or on land? It calls for different things. And also, like, what toxin you're talking about, if it's, you know, if it's a biological pollutant, if it's chemical, or if it's metal, requires different things. But in all, if you can add as many organisms as possible, then that's the best method to go about it. And as slowly as possible. And being conscious of all systems that are interacting with it, whether it's the land, whether it's the different organisms, and including humans. And so that's why it gets tricky with bioremediation, a lot of times with grassroots is like there's governments involved and there's people who are getting paid off by these big industries to be like, I don't want you to clean up that toxic waste because then it's publicized. And so a lot of police agencies and a lot of people are being paid off. So that was a big thing in the Sucumbíos region in Ecuador is they're doing these projects and working on it for years and degrading these oil pits. And overnight it was just like knocked down by bulldozers and you know they would send in results for sampling or send in samples for results and they'd be tampered with. Mm-hmm. So like they would send in a whole vial of just pure oil mm-hmm. and it would be like come back clean. Mm-hmm. And they'd be like, no, it wasn't clean, like that was pure oil. Mm-hmm. So you know, just being conscious of all the different systems that are interacting and your effect, you know, depending on who you are and like where, if it's a place that's not your home, what community you're stepping into, if they're asking for you to help or are you coming in just being like, I'm gonna save the day, it's probably not the best way to go about it. So slowly but surely and adding all organisms, I feel like is the best method. Kind of a complex answer.
I'm just thinking too, I mean, really, it seems clear that this has to start, it's already started small, but as far as like, you know, because we live in a top-down society, and so in these major conservation efforts, like now, in this really impending time to like actively solve this pollution crisis, actively solve all of these incredible messes that we've caused, you know, we being consumers, you know, it's also clear that small initiatives need to get stronger so that, you know, issues like that do not continue to happen. And it's probably directly related to some sort of military thing as well, you know, like if it's calling out a bigger problem as far as like, you know, an industrial presence, particularly in South America, you know, they don't want to acknowledge a lot of the toxic stuff that they're doing or the presence that they have. So as far as an answer goes, it seems clear that like there's so much opportunity at the small scale level to use, the, I mean, particularly with heavy metals, like the absorption of those metals by the fungi, seems like there's a lot of ability to kind of like, you know, for production, whatever that would be, but like whatever we need to build, like there's so much opportunity to do with that, even though they're not edible. Mm-hmm. You know, there's so much down the line we can do. And then proving slowly and slowly that it actually is the most viable way to like clean up our mess, you know?
Right. And one of those ways, like I talked about BTT Technical and absorbing like gold and silver, but there's also companies that are taking mycelium and making building materials out of them.
Yeah.
So that's like one thing to use heavy metal laden mycelium for. You kind of like freeze dry it, it makes these big blocks and you can build a house out of it. You build insulation. At that point, it's not biodegradable afterwards because you still have the heavy metals. But that's an incentive for these, you know, people who want to make money. That's like TerraCycle. They're taking a toxic waste, melting it down, and making a product that you can sell. And so that's, you know, an answer. You can build infrastructure out of it and keep doing it. But you know, something that I've been running into is like, this is kind of a solution for people to keep doing what they're already doing.
Right.
So that's something to talk about. It's like, yeah, this is a solution for toxic waste that we've already produced, and then maybe like when an oil pipe is going to burst, like we have the means to remediate it.
Mm-hmm.
But a bigger issue like is at stake here is like we can't keep doing the same thing we're doing.
Right.
And like we can't keep extracting resources and just like making products in the way we're doing and like disposing them in the means that we're doing and just not having the infrastructure and not having the resources allocated to cleaning up our waste and having like really sustainable means of like fuel and energy and just like any resources that are biodegradable and work with the systems at play.
Mm.
So that's kind of a bigger thing to tackle, but you know, this is one one way that we can kind of solve a little sliver of it, for sure.
Yeah.
And for bees as well, it's really great. I know you're the bee guy, but yeah, for varroa mites and boosting their immune system, and, you know, attacking them, that's a form of micro-remediation, you know, because it's like bees are vital to our ecosystem, so if we're, you know, controlling a toxin, you know, and even pesticides and like, you know, degrading those, and if we can degrade those and if the bees are not being affected by it, then we won't have colony collapse.
Right.
And, you know, we won't die. What's the statistic? If we don't have bees, we'll die in...
Yeah, it's the Einstein quote. It's like, we have like 3 or 4 years.
Yeah. So, kind of shortening, or making that number bigger.
Yeah, for definitely. Mm-hmm.
Does anyone have any final questions? Well, thank you, everyone. No.